Hey, this is Cole Weaver. Welcome to another episode of Designing Hardware. This is part two of the Juno, the Universal Remote Control series. I promised you guys when I made the intro video that I will make a video each time I make progress with this project. And well, I did make progress on this. In fact, I pretty much finished the hardware for the Juno remote control. The next video is gonna be about the software. I just started to write some code and test the modules present on these boards, but it's gonna take a while to finish both firmwares for the microcontrollers, and I will make a video about it as soon as I finish it. So make sure to stay tuned and please subscribe to this channel if you didn't already. And with that being said, let's do this. So it took a little longer than I expected to finish this because I had to redo the PCBs. After I got the first set of boards, I wasn't 100% pleased with the result, and it's painful when this happens, when you have to redo the PCBs, either because you made a mistake or you see something which needs to be adjusted. But this is what prototyping means, and it's not always as easy as it seems. And it does take time, especially when you have limited resources. You have to always think multiple steps ahead, and you have to be able to visualize the finished product before you actually start working on it. Anyway, I drew the schematic again. There were only minor changes. I've rerouted some of the signals from the smaller microcontroller to the bigger one because I had some concerns that the flash of the Mega38-2 won't be big enough for the firmware. And the most important thing, I realized this while looking at the PCBs, the display sitting on the top board may be a little bit too low compared to the thumbsticks. Let me show you what I mean by that. Here's a sketch of the hardware, and my concern is that when I'll start modeling the case for this, the difference in height between the display and the thumbsticks could be an issue. It's not a functional problem, it's just an ergonomical issue. So to solve this problem, I designed two different versions of the top board. The first version has the display mounted on board, and the second version has this connector here, and the LCD sits on an extension board which I designed separately, and it's gonna sit 10 or 11 millimeter higher. There could be a small disadvantage here. Using this method will also increase the total height of the case, and I don't know if I want that. I mean, that's why I made two separate boards. They're 100% compatible with the bottom board, and I guess I'll decide which one I'm gonna use when I'll start working on the case. As soon as I got the new boards, I started separating them from the panels. Did a little bit of cleaning and sanding to remove any imperfections from the cutting blade and to bring them to the same width. Then I started soldering. I'm soldering on three boards at the same time, the both versions of the top board and the display extension board. And the reason for that is it's just easier to place the same components on all the boards. It's faster this way because these boards are pretty much identical. I'm soldering everything manually. I don't know why, but I prefer doing this for the first versions of a prototype. I prefer manual soldering than using a stencil. If the parts are not too small or too complicated footprints, I solder by hand. This is the 50-pin connector for the LCD. And this was the most difficult part to solder on these boards. It's not very complicated, it just takes a little bit of caution and patience. And then I moved on to solder the chips. So the chips first, and then the smallest components, and at last the bigger components and the connectors. Here's the SD card slot. It took several hours to do all the boards, including the bottom board, which you're gonna see next. Doing a little bit of cleaning. Starting to place the micro switches, so soldering one pin, then aligning the switch inspecting again for perfect alignment, and then soldering all the remaining pins. Then I moved on to soldering the thumbsticks. I drew the footprints for these parts myself, and I used them in a couple of other projects before, so I already know they will fit on the PCB. This is the connector which makes this version of the top board different than the other. It's a 28-pin connector for the LCD extension, which allows me to place the display a little bit higher. And after that, it was time to start working on the bottom board. This is the 10 degrees of freedom IMU, which I designed myself. I'm gonna do a separate video about it very soon. Here's how I'm soldering it. I start by turning the board and applying solder from the backside on one of these pads. Then turning the board again, aligning the module to fit on the footprint, using some Kapton tape to hold it in place. Then turning the board again, applying flux and soldering all these plated holes, so the solder will melt and make contact with the pads on the module on the top side. Here I'm soldering the microcontroller on the bottom board. Removing some excess solder. Some capacitors, decoupling capacitors. It took a little longer than if I would have used a stencil. I don't know why, but I prefer to manually solder whenever I'm doing the first versions of a prototype. Stencils are nice when you're doing high volume and you're working on something which has been tested. The layout of the PCB, the electrical plan, the parts, everything has been tested. You know it's working. Then yeah, it's a lot faster to apply solder paste and place the parts and then put the boards in the oven. But whenever I build something like this and it's the first version, I prefer manual soldering. Even if it takes a little bit longer, I don't know, it's like I'm more in control of the whole process. I'm getting a better feeling for everything. Here I'm starting to solder the connectors between the boards. I start by soldering the female connectors. Then I insert the male connectors and place the top board so the holes are aligning with the male connectors. Solder one pin on each connector. Inspect for proper alignment and then solder the remaining pins. I'm cleaning the boards again. There are two LEDs placed on the bottom board. They're visible above the top boards because I have placed some holes on the top boards, so the LEDs would come out through these holes. One of the final steps is mounting the display. Putting everything together just to see how it fits. Looks gorgeous already. You may notice that I've changed the green LED for a blue one. This LED indicates the status of the IMU, if it's active or not, and I think blue looks better. Here's a 3D printed spacer. The LCD extension board will sit on it, and I will use this connector to interface with the top board. This part is the battery cover. I'm sanding it first and then spray painting it. And finally, I'm starting to solder the ISP cables so that I can start flashing the microcontrollers. Everything's in place now, it looks good. Now I'm going to insert the battery connector and check the switching regulator to see if it's working. volts as expected. The first piece of code I wrote is testing the display, the SD card circuitry, because I'm reading a photo from the micro SD card, obviously the microcontroller itself. Alright, so the next step will be to write software which will integrate all these buttons. They're multiplexed via an I2C device which also has an interrupt pin, so I'll be able to detect any changes. Then use the ADC of the microcontroller to read the analog thumbsticks. Write subroutines for the Bluetooth, the infrared transmitter, the long-range communication module, Wi-Fi module, and the 10 degrees of freedom module. And then make a nice graphical user interface. I'll be doing all this in part 3 of this series. Thanks for watching, please subscribe and help me grow this channel, and I'll see you on the next one. This is Core Weaver, signing off.